Hello there.
Hello there.
Welcome, everybody, to our Obi-wan Kenobi Episode 6 finale discussion. I'm joined today with Kaz, Dwarfy McGee, and Higgsy. It's your boy. My Maclunkey Squadron, as they are. for our final Obi-wan Kenobi discussion.
And our final hello there, as you were just saying. Yeah. We've made all of us cry.
I'm not ready for this. But before we get to that, I'm going to pass it on to Kaz. We just want to say a few words at the beginning of the stream about recent events that have kind of been occurring. So,
with everything that's happening with the Supreme Court and Texas and most of the U.S., or not most, but like a fair portion of the U.S., we thought it'd be worth making a statement about the whole situation. The entire cast and the community and the stream itself and just everything we encompass as a whole, as a group, we aim at having a very inclusive, supportive community, and we all are very much pro-choice. And although we're not going to discuss politics of human rights here in chat, we just want to let those know that we support the fight to combat this injustice towards not just women, but men, trans people, transgender, non-binary, just everyone, essentially, because everyone has a right to freedom of their body. And so, yeah, we as a community, we support the stance to fight this, and hopefully we can, through the support and fighting, and we do have a few things planned in the future to help support where we can, such as, like, I'm going to be doing a fundraiser tomorrow. Hopefully we're going to have something with Maclunkey maybe next week or something. We'll have to have a discussion about this.
Definitely the next couple weeks, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
We'll have something, hopefully, to help support. And I will at some point be providing a little, like, research package for people in the Discord and in the various social spaces that we are. So if you are looking to support and you can, please do. And if you are actively protesting or doing anything, please do stay safe and do your research to keep yourself from getting into more trouble than needs be.
But as a rule of thumb, this is a human right. This isn't a case of, to me, this isn't even a gender issue. This is a basic human right that's being taken away from one of the biggest countries in the world. And as Kaz rightly said, we as a community, we have a sense of duty to help provide a safe space for those affected by this. Whether that be through the charity streams that Kaz has got set up and ready to go, or whether that's just through us sharing and trying to help those connect with, you know, various different things. You know, like Kaz rightly said, we're an inclusive community. Obviously, Kaz and myself don't live in America, but it's still very much a big thing for us as well.
Exactly.
You know? This is a very un-American stream right now. Yeah, we don't have a single guy.
Yeah. But that's not like even the thing. Like, it's crazy because, like, this will bleed.
Oh, absolutely.
This will have a knock-on effect to the modern world. The fact that, you know, it's 2022 and we've taken a step back into the archaic days.
Yeah.
And it's upsetting, you know, to think that, you know, if I was in America right now, I wouldn't recognize it from what we were taught as a kid.
Yeah.
So it's a shame. But rather than, you know, the time to dwell on it is over. You know, if you're going to stand for something, let's stand united against this common fault within the society. Let's just stand together. The best thing you can do is stand together right now. Let's not divide any more than it already has been.
Yeah, absolutely. So, with that, are we feeling okay with that, or?
Yeah, it's all good.
All right. Let's move on to the Obi-Wan Kenobi discussion then.
Yes.
Woo!
What did what were your thoughts on it, everyone? We'll go down the line. Kaz, you first. What were your thoughts on this episode?
I absolutely loved this episode. It made me feel like I was watching Revenge of the Sith again, and you guys know Revenge of the Sith is my favorite Star Wars. It's one of my favorite films ever made. Shit almost made me cry. It was beautiful, and like, there was just so much to love, and so much to like. Like, this made me like remember why I loved being a Star Wars fan in a lot of ways.
Preaching right now.
Like, would you say that this episode definitely like increased your overall like number score?
Yeah, no, definitely. Like, I think I came in on like maybe like a six coming to seven, because it was going up. And the episode itself was, if it wasn't a 10, it's a 9, it's 9.5 at the least for me. And so like the way I look at it is, this definitely brought the entire thing up by a significant margin.
Yeah, this episode did a lot of legwork for me. In terms of getting the overall like score and my appreciation of the show up, I think this episode alone did like serious legwork in that regard. But Connor, what did you think?
Well, you know me being the positive person, absolutely loved it. Like,
this is like the one episode that you're like, I actually hated this one.
No, it is so good. Honestly, this is the episode, and I gotta say, it's probably like some of the best cinematography I've ever seen in Star Wars. Like,
yeah, for sure.
There's so many shots that were so beautifully crafted, so many scenes that were like, that's so cool. It's like Duel of the Fates. I never clued in until like a couple years ago, where like Dave Filoni said that like Duel of the Fates is called that because it's like it changes everything depending on who wins that fight. And like with this one, it was very much like there were so many different nods to a bunch of different things, and it was really cool.
There's so many things, man. Like, I'm just remembering like that, like one like discussion they have during the fight, and my heart fucking goes, man.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Dan, what about you?
I watch it's one of the few things I can do with my father. You know, he and I, he was my reason for getting into Star Wars, right? He and I watched it together, and I cried. I was an emotional wreck from about 15 minutes in until the end credits.
Understandable.
Yeah. You know what, Tess? That's spot on. Because, like you said, after watching things like Clone Wars and Rebels, that ending, like, I had goosebumps all through the episode. I was emotional, but for the right reasons. Not like I was sad that it was ending, but I wasn't sad in that way. I was sad that it finally makes sense. After all those years, it was like, this is it. Like, oh my God, this is what we've missed out on. And I was also emotional by the fact that we finally got to see Hayden and Ewan together again in a really, like, in the way that they always should have been.
That is a good point. Also, one thing for me that I noticed that I didn't even really comprehend, because I know that like going into it, and especially with like the first like half of the show, people were like all going on that line from episode 4 where it's like, when I last saw you, I was but the learner, now I'm the master, and everyone was so hooked on that. But then I also go to like episode 6 where like Luke and Ghost Obi-Wan are talking, and he's like, yeah, Vader did like kill your father. He's like more machine than man.
Exactly.
Like, holy shit! Like, he totally is like the split personality, and like they really touch upon that, which I thought was really cool. Mm-hmm. They totally forgot that was a conversation that happens in those movies.
I think like there's a like a bit in the like I don't know if like it was deliberate, but like it's like a headcanon kind of thing. It's like almost like Anakin is still there fighting him, fighting Vader, and trying to like not let it take over, but there's bits where like then that's like at that moment where it's like, oh no, like you didn't kill him, Obi-Wan. That's where Vader finally kills Anakin.
Also, one thing that I saw somebody post that I thought was really neat, and I don't know if you saw this or anything, Sam, but when Vader's mask goes,
it's the opposite side to Ahsoka's.
Whereas, like, when it happens in another time in another show, it's the left.
Yeah, in Rebels, I noticed that kind of thing for sure, and I thought that was cool, but...
Now, here's what I thought about that. So, Ahsoka got the left side in Rebels, spoiler, and Kenobi got the right side. Now, my dad actually said something that kind of made sense to me. he said maybe it's that's the two halves of Anakin that remained, and his heart was always Padme, right? But in his head, the two halves of him was his master and his apprentice. And the fact that they both did the exact same thing to him,
it's so clear that in episode 6 when Luke removes the helmet, he was the one to
free Anakin, not show Anakin, free Anakin, finally set him free. So that parallel between the three of them is actually incredibly well put together if you think about it.
Right? Mm. That was something that I noticed afterwards, someone posted that, and I was like, holy shit, that is so cool.
Yeah.
That was a really cool connective thing. Talking about the connective tissue stuff where it's I'm more on board for sure now after these episodes with all the lines that are connecting things, the big one, which was I was a learner, now I'm the master, whatever, that was my big one. There's the line in Return of the Jedi where Darth Vader says, Obi-Wan once thought as you do, even though that never really happened. This show kind of did show that now. But the only thing that I still feel kind of weird about is the fact that Obi-Wan is super adamant to Luke, you have to kill him. You have to kill him. But at the end of this show, he was no, I can't do it. I'm not going to kill him. So
that's because he can't, because he's got such a great relationship with him.
The other thing to bear in mind as well is the reason Obi-Wan's telling him to do it is because, similar thing.
He's not strong enough to do it himself.
Yeah, Obi-Wan could never do it himself, as we all know. I don't know. There's a lot to it, really, because, and it's the same with the whole master, the whole, when I left you, I was but the learner, now I'm the master. To an extent, yeah, but...
Well, that one they definitely showed, within the show, making sense narratively, that he is still in a place of, learning, and he... The flashbacks from last episode, it was very clear that when Obi-Wan was said, until you have learned these lessons, a Padawan you will remain. And he was well, shit, I'm still fucking up. I'm still doing that.
Think about it as well. The only time, right, that Vader has seen that lesson come to life is when Luke showed mercy in Return of the Jedi. That is how he won Vader. How he won Anakin back was he showed mercy. So that actually makes more sense now, because it's the lesson that he recalls from Obi-Wan the most because of his killing sprees and stuff as the Dark Lord of the Sith.
Yeah. I'm just more so saying I would like to have seen, from Obi-Wan some... Not sadness sure at the very end, but I would have liked to see some commitment to the fact that Anakin needs to die. I needed to see him be he can't be saved, or something like that. Because he doesn't even think that Luke can do it. He literally is you gotta go kill him. It's unfortunate that now you know that he's your father, but you gotta do it. There's no other way to do it. If you don't do it, the Emperor has already won. Those are literally... And that's what made Luke in the original trilogy, the beacon, in my opinion. Where it was even Obi-Wan Kenobi, the Force ghost, the guy who has gone through all this training to get to this level, is still telling Luke, you have to kill him. There's no other way. So Luke...
But maybe in hindsight, right? Maybe he knows Luke wasn't going to do it. Maybe that's the point. Maybe the point of Obi-Wan saying you need to kill him is that Luke does show mercy. And to not follow the same mistake that Kenobi did, but also not to follow the same mistake Anakin did.
I mean, potentially, but if that's the case, then we're getting into some sort of weird retcon-y things where it's Obi-Wan saying things to push him in a direction where it's he could have just been no, you could turn him, you know?
Yeah, I think he was a lot more literal.
Yeah. It feels like there's potential for, I don't want to be that guy, but season 2 of fucking Kenobi or some shit, because... That's been in the talks, apparently, where...
I hope not.
I hope not, just for the sole reason of, I don't like it when things are we're gonna make this a one-off, and then it makes a lot of money, and then they're we're gonna make season 2! And I'm don't fucking do that just because you made money. You had a good story, and you knew you wanted to do a one thing, don't just do more because you made money. I say that as, like, we're talking about Star Wars, which is the pinnacle of that.
Yeah.
But the only reason that this franchise happened was because A New Hope made $1 trillion, so.
True.
But hey, I think that there's times to do it and there's times not to do it. You know, like, if you have actual inspiration and story to tell, go for it, sure. But
yeah,
if you're just doing it because money, then don't.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But shall we get down to the episode then, or?
Yes.
All right. So this episode opened with Reva on Tatooine already, kind of harassing the guy from the first episode that was Obi-Wan's boss. I love seeing that guy get a little bit of his comeuppance. But what did you guys think about, like, the whole, like, Reva interconnected kind of story with her stuff going on alongside Darth Vader and Obi-Wan?
I do think the initial, like, why is she, like, after, like, why does she, like, know Luke is important kind of thing was, I'm not confused, I wouldn't say confused, but it was, like, kind of a, huh? Kind of thing. Like we know he's important. Like, how does she know he is, like, this important, if that makes sense? Like, how does she know to look for specifically Luke and Owen?
Well, to be fair, like, in the last episode, and on the recorder, the recorder with the key convenient information.
Thanks, Bale, by the way, for, I need to address that, because, like, I love Bail Organa. Like, he is the real daddy of Star Wars. But, he's like, wow, let's have just Leia just roaming around. Oh, she got kidnapped. Shit, let's break Obi-Wan out of hiding. Okay. And then he's like, I'm going to give all the information out. Here's my address. Here's where I live.
And, like, all this shit. And I'm like, Iron Man 3.
I loved it that it was all the bullshit information, of course, was just like, it was like, Tatooine, Owen, the boy. And it's like, of course, yeah. So, like, okay, I got my game plan. And, like, there's only one guy named Owen on Tatooine, apparently, so
mm-hmm.
He's just easy also to find.
That it was the Owen that Reva met earlier.
Yeah, right, exactly. That's also the thing that makes me think that, like, when we see that the scale of Star Wars is so small, with, like, the fact that the Death Star is, or Starkiller Base is apparently even smaller than our moon. Like, I actually think that Star Wars planets are as big as a country. I think that you might know people. Like, when they ask, like, do you know an Owen? They're like, yeah, there's, like, two.
There's, like, two.
That's why she was there at night, because she was looking for the other Owen.
Yeah, she was like, I went all the way to the other goddamn side of this planet to find Owen Marsh.
It could be small, right? Like, it could just be, like Mars and stuff like that. Like, you know, like...
Well, see, but Mars is a pretty large planet. That's the thing. Like, all the planets...
Isn't it smaller than Earth?
I think Mars and Earth are... Mars and Earth are...
I like to think that Pluto's still a planet. Let's say Pluto.
Yeah. And even then, I think that a lot of them are smaller than that. Because big. Yeah, because the thing is, like, compared to... Like, Death Star... Or the Starkiller Base is smaller than our moon, right? So Ilum, theoretically, as a large planet in Star Wars, is, like, small to us. Like, it's a really weird universe in that way.
Or we could just ignore the fact that somebody said it was smaller than our moon, because I feel like that's like the GIF guy being like, yeah, it's pronounced GIF, and it's like, no, it's not. That's
yeah,
not
how that like, works. George, if you did research, you should have made these sizes a little bit goddamn bigger. You should have at least made the Death Star as big as the moon. That's the whole fucking thing. They're like, that's no moon. To us, that would be like, I want to be able to look up into the sky and see the Death Star as if it was the moon.
Yeah.
Not some dinky little speck. Cool. But yeah, I don't know, I felt kind of weird with, like, the flow of the narrative in this one, where, like, we were cutting back and forth in kind of key moments with Reva, especially during the duel. I think that it happened a couple times during the duel.
Yeah, there was some weird cutting in and out on the duel. And just, like, I think it was just a bit too dark to realize, like, with, like, I mean, like, there was, like, that one punch or whatever, like, Owen throws. I was like, huh? What did he just do? And, like, how did, kind of thing. Like, it's, I think it was just a bit too dark.
I have two things for the Reva thing. And as someone who, like, was, like, the only person that was positive about Reva coming at the end of the tunnel thing, this is what I gotta say about this. How the fuck did she get there so quickly when, obviously, like, when it cuts to, like, Reva's already on Tatooine. Like she's already there. But it's, like, and then it cuts to, like, Obi-Wan and Leia in the ship avoiding the Star Destroyer that they just left.
Yeah, like, I guess you could, like, that she, like, hyper... She, like, I don't know, there's no ships around. Maybe
there was. Well, that's the other thing, too. Like, they just left. Like, did she, like, conveniently hop on a ship? Like, did she crawl away?
Yeah, like, that's like, the kind of thing, like, yeah, like, I would have liked to have seen that. I felt like the episode was going to open on that instead of her on Tatooine already. I thought it was going to be her, like, crawling through the sand of Jabim, like, trying to, like, find a way off.
Yeah.
And that might have been able to help with the pacing a little bit with, like, of how things were building during the fight. Like, if she just got to Tatooine when the fight was, like, wrapping, I think that would have been something to do to make it feel more engaging throughout the entire episode.
Mm-hmm.
Rather than kind of like taking your attention away from what you're wanting to see with the Obi-Wan versus Vader thing, you know what I mean? Like, yeah. That's kind of what I'm saying, where it's like I just feel like obviously people are watching the show for this. I think, like, from the online reception of this episode, you can really gather that, like, yeah, this is what people wanted in this show, like, just this episode almost, because I've seen people saying that they might not watch the show, but they'll rewatch this episode.
I can understand that, and like I feel like I could be in that, like, I think like this episode was just a lot of fun, you know what I mean? Like,
yeah, absolutely.
It's kind of like how like I could like Cowboy Bebop is great, and like, but like I'll still only like I might just want to go back and watch like a handful of episodes,
yeah,
or like or Dragon Ball, I'll only watch like one season instead of the entire fucking thing, like,
yeah, which makes sense.
Yeah, like, and I think that we're gonna, Star Wars is the biggest one for this, where you have people in the fandom who just make like edits of things, and I honestly think that we will see an edit of the Obi-Wan Kenobi show down into like a 3-hour movie or something like that. Like, yeah, I think, genuinely believe that.
Yeah. I think was it Khan that was even saying this could be a movie?
I think we've all been saying that, like, for the last couple episodes especially. Like, this was originally planned to be a movie.
Yeah, and then Solo didn't do too well, and Kathleen Kennedy was like, people don't want things like Solo, and it's like...
Yeah, it's like, that's not what you should have gotten from that.
You do not get the point. You do not get the point of that.
Yeah, that's not the loss we should have interpreted from that necessarily, but yeah. Because I honestly think it would have been maybe a better movie, like, especially for me with the whole, like, first three episodes being very meh for me, like... I think that if it had been, like, popped into a movie, it all would have been fixed. I think it all, like, pacing-wise would have just been condensed to a nice, like, 2.5-hour movie. Like, how long was Logan? Wasn't it 2.5 hours or something like that? Or
yeah, roughly around 2.5 hours.
Yeah, like, I think a Logan-length movie for Obi-Wan would be fitting. And it would also be theoretically the same kind of movie with, like, X-23 as Leia, but still. But yeah, then the next scene we get is, like we were saying, the path are on the ship getting chased by Vader, and Obi-Wan is like, yo, bro, I gotta
leave.
Love
the shots, by the way, that it was like episode 4.
Yes, right? Dude, so many... Okay, actually, another thing I gotta bring up from this episode that I wanna ask you guys. Do you guys think that the music in this episode was put in afterwards? Because of complaints people were making about the music?
I think it was
because this episode literally had like 4 motifs, like all play, and it was very like, whoa.
I just thought it was homages.
For sure, but it felt very insane to like, not spread them out and just throw them around, or like in this one episode.
Yeah. If they wrote them specifically for this one episode, then no. But if they if the songs were like new and fresh, then like, no, yeah, I think that they were already written. But if these were like songs that were used previously, I think then yes, because I have heard from other people complaining about like the audio direction or production hasn't been super great in point on when you're watching on like home studios and stuff, for example, or like. Well, and like, because I feel like with being on like listening through earphones, I don't really hear much. I mean, there is times where like the audio is like where like they're whispering and you can't hear them.
But I even mean just like that. Just with the music in general, right? Where since the show is released like week to week, and they can kind of gauge certain things, like I truly wonder if they are like listening to people complaining about there not being any themes, because people, especially with the certain Empire theme, I can't really. The one that, like, is kind of like, dum, dum, da-da-dum, like that new one that they've been doing a lot of. People complain about that as the fact that, like, why can't that be Imperial March? So then it's very funny that it, in this episode specifically, they throw in the Imperial March. I was like...
Yeah, I mean, the other thing I will say to that is, do you know how much work it would be more than a week for them to be able to do that?
You say that, but they've done things like that before in these shows where they like edit it right at that point. And that's just like a track. Like, that's literally just like it's replaced.
No, that's why I say, like, that's why my argument or point on that is maybe they did, and that's why in certain places the audio is a bit more spotty than
possibly
other places.
Then, yeah.
It's kind of like, in general, I see Star Wars as this thing where, since George Lucas went back and redid, like, a bunch of shit for the original trilogy, I feel like Star Wars is this very malleable thing that at one point we could go back to this show and fix it up. You know what I mean? Like,
speaking of that, I've heard, so, like, now that, like, the prequels are, like, 20 years old, this is around the time that the other editions would start coming out, that they'd start fixing
Revenge of the Sith. Like a 4K remastered with like updated CGI, I would not be mad.
I actually have seen a YouTube video recently that says something about that, kind of where it's talking about like an updated CGI for the prequels, if that rings any bells to you guys.
Would love for that shit.
Yeah, it depends on how it looks, but yeah, like I would definitely, if they were like, we're gonna re-update these movies, I would be like, oh shit. Let's see.
Like, re-release them as well, like they did for the original trilogy? I'd be up for that.
I was so bummed out back in, like, I think it was 2014 or something like that, like, right before Disney bought Star Wars, because they re-released Phantom Menace in theaters as 3D, and I was like, oh, hell yeah, I get to go see all the Star Wars again. And then they only did that for that movie because Disney bought them next year.
Yeah.
Fucking bummer. Yeah, I wanted to see Revenge of the Sith again.
Yeah.
Who doesn't? I'm alright, guys.
Yeah. And then back on Tatooine, we got our another shot with Owen and Luke for our first time. He gets his first little lines. And also...
That kid was so happy to be there. Like, he was like, so much Leia, time for Luke to come in.
It's my turn. His first line is, we need a new belt for the speeder. Also, I love the alien here and how he says howdy. He's got like the funniest look to him, like his like mutton chop beard thing, but no mouth.
Yeah.
Like, I was very confused at what I was looking at. I love him though. I might want to be that alien in our Star Wars D&D.
Maybe. You
I'll
can.
Change. I'll change entirely just for this guy.
I think he might be an Aqualish though.
I don't think that's an Aqualish at all. In no way that's an Aqualish.
I don't think so.
No way.
And I'll have to, confirm.
Aqualish would have a ball sack on their mouth. Like, that's what happens.
Beautiful.
This be true.
And then the guy that Reva was coming at earlier, like, conveniently just finds Owen here. And is like, yo, an Inquisitor's coming to get you. Or some evil chick. I don't understand, really, but she was mean.
Also, like, did that guy know?
What do you mean?
Was he like, yo, like a quizzer, you knows that you have a Jedi, and it's like, oh, and do you have a Jedi? Does everyone know?
Well, I think that she probably was just like, yo, like, where is this Owen guy, and like, he has a kid and shit like that. Like, where is this person? I don't think that
don't think
she like, yeah, I don't think she said any specific information.
She's like, yeah, like, where the fuck is he?
She's like, where's Owen? Where is this son of a bitch? I need to kill his kid. But yeah, I really liked. Also, like, we're going back to Obi-Wan on the ship. The aspect of Obi-Wan saying to everyone here on the ship that, like, pretty much I am the past. I can leave. You guys need to survive because you are the future of, like, this rebellion. That was really good. I like that kind of thing where, like, this person from, like, an older time can acknowledge that, like...
And passing the torch.
Yeah, exactly. That, like, it's not up to me anymore. Like, you guys are the new heroes, pretty much. Not to quote Homelander, but you're the real heroes.
Oh my god.
please.
Yeah, and not being a dick about it when I say it either. But yeah, and that's kind of what I'm saying too, is like, see, notice how like with this episode I keep saying like we're jumping back and forth, we're back and forth. We're here with Obi-Wan and the ship, we're here with Amperu and all this shit, like that was my biggest problem with the episode, I think, overall, was just like the jumping back and forth and the pacing of it.
Yeah, that I would agree with. It was a bit, it was not hard to follow, but it was like, oh god, okay, we're back. No, we're back. No, we're back.
It was very ping-pongy, right? Like you're in a pinball machine of like, where am I going? Where, what are we doing?
Yeah, I was a little bit like that. I'll give you that much. I'll give you that much, Sam. I'll agree with you to that extent.
But we did get to see, I always love seeing like the Lars homestead or whatever. Like it's such like a cool, I was saying to Paris,
it's very pretty.
It's very pretty. I would go here and raid the set and just live here.
It's in Tunisia.
Tunisia, yeah. It's like, it's a very beautiful place. Let's rip it out of the ground and take it here.
Yeah. Fuck it. This'll do.
Yeah, and I love that they also show that Beru is like the one who's way more ready to for this situation. Like, she whips out that shotgun. That Owen's like, what? Like, where'd you have this stored away the entire time?
She's just like, bring it, bitch. I'll fuck you up.
Which I guarantee you, yeah, some people are going to bitch about and complain. They're going to be like, oh, they're showing that Owen is a dumb male who doesn't know, like, what to do in this situation. But it's like, fucking hell, people.
On the Reddit, like, when I was on Reddit at this point, I think there was a few things about it, talking about how, like, Beru, just being, a true fucking G.
So yeah, valuable player.
All I've seen is positivity so far, but like, yes, there is definitely going to be the trash.
Definitely going to be people who are saying stupid shit. But then Obi-Wan gives Leia Tala's holster. And I love his cute little, like, of course I'm not going to give you a blaster, you're 10.
Yeah, I do love that. But also, I think that was really sweet, but then I thought about it more, and I was like, we just saw her explode herself, though. Wouldn't that be tattered at least a little bit?
Yeah, that's kind of a good point. Well, I don't know if that was when they would have gotten that. I think it was just something of her belongings, like, that wasn't on her at the time.
But it's a holster.
Yeah, but not you. You have other holsters sometimes.
You don't have a holster on you.
Maybe you have the holster on you, and then you're like, I have my secondary holster, like, back of my supplies. I don't know, because that holster might get fucked. I don't think they would have had the time yet to go back and grab that from her dead body, so. I don't think that was supposed to be the same one. But I also wonder, too, like, I haven't really gone back and watched any clips of this, per se, but, like, I wonder if the holster that Tala gave her is actually something that we see in the other movies. Like, if that's supposed to be the holster that Leia has in, like, Empire Strikes Back or some shit like that.
Maybe.
I don't know. It can be what I believe, I guess, going forward, but it's a weird one. Then we had kind of our first, in my opinion, little Qui-Gon tease. Because on the ship, he tries to communicate with him.
It doesn't work.
And even the shot, like, even the fucking, like, the place he's in, the framing of it, he was on the left side, and there was a whole area open for Qui-Gon to show up.
Yeah.
So I was thinking it was happening right there, but nope. Okay. We'll have to wait for that one.
Yeah.
Because then Roken comes in and is like, I'm going to interrupt your meeting with Qui-Gon. Because can you imagine if Qui-Gon was starting to form right there and it was just Roken that walked in? I'm trying my best here, man.
Man, it's going to happen.
I know that at the end of this scene too, Roken is very much like, I'm just getting started. Do you guys think we're going to see Roken in any other projects?
He's going to be the new Saw Gerrera.
Yeah, like I kind of had that vibe exactly. I'm not going to lie. I think we'll see him in Andor. I genuinely do, since that's like the next thing.
Would be cool. Would be really, like, he's the one who's like, hey, this kid looks kind of promising. Or why don't we give him a shot? And it's like, fuck yes.
Yeah, like, because like the way that he was set up, it definitely felt like they're thinking he's going to appear in other things. And not to mention too, like the whole Reva thing where there's rumors of her getting a spinoff, which I honestly hope that doesn't happen. Not to be mean to Moses Ingram. I don't think that she should have her own show. I think that she should appear in another show, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
I think the story of Reva's been told, basically.
Exactly. Like, that it felt like, even though it's the Obi-Wan show, it also feels like a lot of Reva's show as well. So I'm like, I don't know. I'll say this again. It's like, not that I wouldn't, like, I'll take it if it's a thing, but, like, I feel like there's so many other characters I'd much rather, like their story, to hear about their stories.
Yeah, like, I think we were saying how, like, if she showed up in other things, that'd be cool, but I don't think she needs something for herself now.
No. That ship has well and truly sailed.
Yeah. And then we get to see the Grand Inquisitor kind of making some statements against, not against Vader, but, like, kind of trying to be like, yo, Vader, maybe we shouldn't go after Obi-Wan specifically, because we can take out an entire, like, not rebel cell yet, but we can take out, like, an entire, like, group here of problem people.
Bold of him to assume that Vader would listen.
Yeah, I like that, actually. I thought he was going to get a force choke or something like that for even saying that. But it seems like their relationship is pretty, like, chill. Like, they're kind of like...
Well, you gotta think, he's the Grand Inquisitor for a reason. Like, he's gotta have, like, a little bit more...
He's the Grand Inquisitor because Vader can kick the shit out of him at any second.
Yeah.
That's the thing about the Inquisitors.
Vader can do it.
That's the thing I like about the Inquisitors, is the sense that, like, they're all fallen Jedi that were not really that strong to begin with. So they're not really, like, the biggest threats. Like, yeah, like, if they show up to a non-Force user, oh, fuck. But if you're, like, someone who's, like a normal, decent Jedi, I think that you might even have a chance against them.
Yeah.
I mean, look at Cal, right? Like, he was, like, just a dude.
Yeah, he was just a Padawan. He kicked their, like, asses multiple times.
Oh, I also forgot to mention, for Tess, Tess had a mention in this episode, in a way, because they have to go to the planet Tessin. So... I can't wait until we all get our respective planets, where we go to, like, Salmon or Conoran and Dannon and Kazan.
I think we're gonna be waiting. So well, there was a Jedi in an old game called Kazan Baratus. So is that? It's kind of close, I guess. Whereas me, I got a while, bro.
Yeah, but like. That's a Jedi, so that's already a name. I think
they said, like, Dannon or something like that.
Like, sure. Well, I'm talking about planet names, though. Tess got named after a planet. Or not, no. They named the planet after Tess. That's what we're saying.
Yes.
She's also in Marvel.
Is she?
She's
the Tesseract. I gotcha. Jesus. I was like, what could it be? Son. I thought it was going to be, like, a place again. I was thinking of, like, a planet that someone was from. But yeah, before he left, cause they didn't really show this implication or anything like that later, but did you guys think that Leia, purposely put Lola in Obi-Wan's thing?
Yes. Okay. Yes. Don't even question it. That was her subtle way of saying, you best come back, cause I want that bloody droid back.
Like, I didn't pick up on it myself. But, like, when you guys mentioned, I think you guys even said, like, I'm like, oh, shit, yeah, that's spot on.
It's very cute, and I do like that idea. I think that that's a very sweet thing to do, because immediately, like, you're like, oh, yeah, like, he's got to bring Lola back. He's got to see her one last time.
Yeah.
Like, this ain't it. But, yeah, now we are at the moment, folks. We are at probably the best part of the entire fucking episode for me. Where, like, this duel was holy shit.
This, for me, like, was almost... I think this is my favorite battle in all of Star Wars, and I think it's peak Star Wars.
Yeah, I would almost say, like, this is up there. Pardon, Connor?
I thought it was fantastic.
Yeah, I would say it's up there in my top five favorite lightsaber battles in Star Wars in general. And I like that this battle, we get to see a lot of the Force being used during it.
Yes.
Specifically, my favorite moment might be literally when that rock is coming down, and Vader, like, just, like, tosses it away like it's nothing. Like, He's, like, resisting it for a second, but then it's, like, boom, it's nothing. Like,
so
that...
Also, I gotta point out, there's a scene that we watched, like, three times over because we were laughing so fucking hard. And it's when he gets the rock chucked at his face.
Right?
He goes, oh! And I was like, oh, that's so good. That's fucking mint.
This fight was, like, the reference fight for sure, too, where it was, like, he says at the very beginning, I will do what I must. He goes into
Sarisu.
That's what that is? Okay.
He is the master of Sarisu, the defensive technique.
So he goes into that stance, and so it's just shit like that, where it's like things that you know that the fan base is going to be like, yeah!
Yeah, instantly, like, I screamed at the screen, he did the thing!
And I gotta say immediately, like, just the fact that we're on an actual, like, alien planet, like, I get that it's just rocks with spires, but it's definitely a lot more interesting to look at than a planet that was a quarry in episode 3. Like, that area that they were battling into me just was lame and disappointing visually for a battle to even take place in. It felt very fan-filmy. Whereas this, it was like, this fucking feels like a Star Wars movie battle. Like, here we go.
Because it was even down to, like the mist and the fog and stuff. That was good. That was really good.
Do you guys know that the new lightsabers that Disney's been using, actually? Because, like, since, I think in 2005, yeah, like, they were still just using, like, green screen type.
Sticks.
Yeah, sticks and stuff like that. But now with the actual lightsaber effect things that they use, they get, like, genuine lighting on the characters and stuff. So I actually feel like a lot of that comes through a lot more beautifully. I would even say I like that in... I'm not a huge fan of the lightsaber battles in the sequel trilogy, but I think that that's a better element to them than the other ones, is that the lighting during the battles is great.
Yeah. Because they're essentially, like, what we would call, like, custom lightsabers. Where it's got, like, the virtually indestructible blade... So it can take being dualed.
Yeah.
It's still, like, accurate sizing, just without noise. It's basically what we would call a glow stick. But it's really good.
Yeah, and it can give off the actual lighting. That's the thing I like about the new Star Wars stuff, is, like, this... Especially with, like, going away from green screen technology and shit like that, with, like, the volume. We get, like, actual lighting from these screens that we're getting, so it doesn't... We don't have to, like, digitally put in the proper lighting. We can just fix it there. I think that's an incredible step for Star Wars filmmaking in general. So,
yeah.
Like, the cinematography in this fight was pretty great. A little shaky cam, but I don't know. Like, that seems to just be the way nowadays.
Also, like, one thing that I really liked, and, like, it's almost like an homage to the sequel trilogy, but I feel like it's, like, an homage to, like, what a lot of people think, is, like, with Obi-Wan with, like, the rocks coming out.
Yeah, absolutely.
And I was like, that is so cool. Like, it's a little cheesy, but I love it.
Well, it's awesome, you know? Like, it's cool to see the Force being used in a battle like that. Like, that's always what we've been saying.
I would argue the build-up to that was also just as cool.
Yeah, well,
He's struggling.
That was also fucking intense.
And then, like, it's like something he just, like, he snaps. Like, he doesn't, like, it's like, oh, I'm finally got my Force back. He's like, he snaps. You can visibly see him snap. Because the second that Leia starts going over his head and Luke, he's like... fuck this, starts hearing the voices, and he's like,
well, because he's stuck in the past, but when he thinks of the future, that's what gets him out of there. Like, that's what finally is like, I need to do this because the future needs me. I need to still be here for them.
Yeah. And that, to me, when he does that, wild. And then he's like, just fucking comes up, sneaks up
on him. He pulls the Vader! I love that! Yeah, like that he fucking pulled the Vader from episode 3. He did that shit to him.
Also, speaking of that shot, I like that shot when, like, Vader's just walking and it's, like, panning over the rocks and you can see him. Like, it looks so cool.
Yeah, that shot reminded me of the shot in Rebels when he loses to Ahsoka, where he's, like, walking.
Yeah.
I can't remember what the plan... No, it wasn't Warben. What was that?
Yeah, it was Corban.
No, it wasn't. No way.
Yeah, it was. They're on the Sith home planet.
I don't think they were. But it reminded me of that shot that he is, like, walking out of the temple and stuff like that, and he's all broken and destructed. He wasn't broken in this, but it reminded me of that shot for sure.
Yeah.
Definitely had a lot taken out of him, like, emotionally during this fight. But we come back to Reva probing around the place. I made this joke, and it's genuinely fucking hilarious to me. There's a part where Owen, like, kicks down a flower pot at Reva.
Mm.
And I genuinely like to think that Owen was, like, looking for an excuse to get rid of a certain fucking flower pot that he didn't like and shit. And he's like, and kick this at Reva. Oh, Baru, like, sorry, your favorite plant that was destroyed.
What a shame. That flower's
gone. My favorite thing
about
the whole Reva fight, by the way, and, like, I totally understand, like, it's Owen and Baru, like, they can't die, they can't get attacked, because it'll break the cannon. And it's just really funny to show that they're, like, kicking her ass, and she's like, oh, I'm still very injured, this is a terrible idea, why am I doing this?
Yeah, and it makes you wonder how many stormtroopers these two took down back in fucking A New Hope, you know, like, off-screen before they got fucking fried.
Yeah.
They took down, like, 18 stormtroopers, an entire platoon.
Lord Vader says, you can now laugh at the Little Orphan Annie joke.
It was funny then, and it's funny now.
So good.
A little robot chicken humor for you guys.
We should marathon that. We should marathon the three Star Wars robot chickens.
Yeah, yeah, I'd be down. Good. They're great.
They're amazing. Best, some of the best Star Wars content out there. Just saying.
It's I'm back from the dead, bitches. Making it rain purple on these bitches. Fucking oh, what a show. The Yo Mama joke battle. Oh,
so good.
Just even like the Uncle Owen line too, where he said where she's like. Fuck, she said something like, you love him like your own?
You love him like your own. Yeah. He's like, he's my own.
And it's like, that's not even wrong. You know what I mean? Like, yeah. That's, he is straight up his nephew or something like that. So it's not like he isn't family.
Family. Yeah. Also, like, okay. I know that, like, Reva, one thing I didn't really understand, essentially, was, like, Reva went there. And at first it was like, because, like, she doesn't know that Luke is Vader's son. She just knows that Obi-Wan was protecting Leia and Luke. Mm. And then I was like, was Reva going to, like, capture him? Like, that's, I thought she was going to capture him and, like, train him to be an apprentice. But it's like, no, she's just going to kill him. And I was like, but why?
I think that really at that moment, she just wanted to hurt Obi-Wan. I think that in the dark side, like, in her mind there, like, the only thing to do right now in her moment of loss and or I don't even know what you'd say for loss or defeat, that would be a bigger word for it.
Yeah.
In her moment of defeat, the only thing that she has is this knowledge of something that will hurt Obi-Wan, and in the dark side that will push you, right?
Yeah,
like that's what the Inquisitor said last episode, right? Where it's like revenge is a great motivator to live or whatever he said. That's not the wording he said, but that would be very funny if he said it like that. Revenge is a great motivator to live. You'd be like, what? Who wrote that line?
Somehow I have returned.
Don't. Dude, actually, okay. If they had said that in the fucking last episode, like if the Inquisitor showed up and was like, somehow I have returned, I actually would be like, kudos to these guys for fucking making jokes about that writing. Like when we can be at a place of self-referential, like jokes, I feel with Star Wars, then we're in a good place. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Where it's like we can acknowledge that we did goof at one point.
We goof.
But yeah, where are we now?
We're up to that very, very, very emotionally driven scene.
Hmm.
Yeah, like,
that took a lot out of me that soon.
Even just like the move that Obi-Wan did to strike at Vader, where he did that like jump. What is that from? That's from a thing already. He did like the Rebels. Pardon?
He recreated what Ahsoka did.
Nah, but I think what I'm thinking of is more live action, because like his is very horizontal, whereas hers was like kind of like Like, I'm more so, because she didn't have anything to jump off of. Someone definitely had to do a jump off of to do something that I'm thinking of here.
Oh.
Because he does, like, a Superman fly for, like, 1 second in this scene. You know what I mean? Like, he's straight up horizontal flying.
Are you talking about Starkiller, maybe?
Maybe. I feel like it might have been in a game thing. Maybe it was Cal.
Possibly Starkiller.
Because, yeah, like, I just remember specifically, like, the motion of this attack. It's very familiar. But yeah, this is to me like the highlight of the episode too. Seeing Hayden behind the mask and actually giving lines, the mixture of James Earl Jones and his voice.
Also, I loved when Obi-Wan was beating the shit out of his fucking voice box, by the way.
Yeah, right.
With the voice, boom, boom.
Yeah, the second you hear Vader in that like in that breathing mode where he's like, oh shit, I'm fucking going down, that's when you know you're like in a good place.
One of my favorite scenes in that, like, with the like fight scenes, like, when they're holding each other's hands and trying to, like, gank each other.
Right? Yeah.
Like, I was like, holy shit.
And again, like, the visuals here are always so good with the colors. They did this in Force Awakens as well, but they showed, like, the blue when Anakin was still in maybe, like, a place of... Well, to him, he wasn't in, like, a mentally good place. But to the viewers, it sounds like maybe he's saying some good shit. But then when he says the evil shit, the red lightsaber, like, comes in and takes over the color on his face. And I just love that shit. Like, that shit to me is so good. Like, they did that in the Return of the Jedi as well. But, like, just the ways that lighting can convey emotion in a scene is, like, super impactful. And, of course, like, this is the scene where we get the callback line as well to Return of the Jedi, where Obi-Wan says, "Then my friend is truly dead."
Oh, so sad.
Which, yeah, like, that kind of thing. I love that, because then it really does add to that moment in Return of the Jedi where Vader, like, after he says that, it's my favorite fucking... Literally, my favorite moment in Return of the Jedi is Vader leaning on a beam. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, it's nothing else.
I remember he went in on this one.
Yeah, like, it's literally just the fact that he hears that, waits until nobody can see him, and then goes over to the fucking balcony. He's like, holy shit. Like, this kid is hitting me with truths, and I need to think about it for a second. Like, what is happening?
Yeah. He's like, I need to take a breather. And so...
Like, and even just the lines, too. Like, that whole scene where he says, fuck, it is too late for me, my son. Like, he acknowledges in that moment that he, at least to me, like, it sounds like he regrets it, right? Like, he... Yeah.
Well, of course he does. Doesn't he spend, like, his whole time regretting it?
Like, absolutely. Like that's the fuel for his rage, pretty much, is this regret of his life. But... It's just beautiful to see that kind of come back with Obi-Wan, and that's, to me, what makes that later scene more impactful now, is that he probably in that moment thinks back to this now and is like, fuck. Like, Luke and Obi-Wan, like, yeah, like, Obi-Wan once thought as you do. Like, ah! This fucking episode did waves for this show in general, because now I'm into the show. You know what I mean? Like, that... This fucking part, like, saves it. Hardcore.
And it's also the replayability of that scene. It's emotionally...
Like, you watch... When, like you... Some people... Like, I've never watched Rebels, but I've watched that fight between Ahsoka and Vader. So, like just having, like, that... Like, even, like, people that, like, aren't watching the show itself, like, go for, like, the moments. It's there.
It's there.
Tadam.
There you go.
Sorry, Dan. Didn't mean like come in like and like take away from your point. Like to add, more so to hopefully add to like what you were saying. Sorry, continue.
I must admit, like the moment where Anakin is now looking at Kenobi, and you can see just the facial expressions that Hayden Christensen is putting, where it's like you can see the conflict on his face. Because Darth Vader wants to kill Obi-Wan. Anakin, I think, does not. There is still that element of Anakin where he's like, but you're my master. You're like a father to me.
Like,
and then Vader's like, nah, I want you gone.
And like, there are moments like that that are better shown in, I would say, things like Rebels, right? Because animation, you can kind of subtly show things a little bit easier than like an acting thing, in my opinion, right? Because like, everything in an animation is always meant to be there and implied in a way. So, like, when you see Anakin react to Ahsoka saying something in Rebels, there's a moment where, like, his eyes kind of are... It looks like he's taken aback and he actually is considering what she says until finally at the very end, like, resolving into hatred and, like, the then you will die. You know what I mean? But there's a moment there where it seems like what she says is kind of getting through to him.
Yeah.
Whereas, like, I don't know. Like, that's what's hard about this part, right? With all the makeup and prosthetics, not prosthetics per se, but all the shit that's on Hayden Christensen, it's hard to convey that kind of moment, maybe. But I think that the antithesis of that is that when he was going into it and he was saying that I killed Anakin, he smiled. Like, he literally looked... Yeah. He looked... What's the word I'm looking for? Like, malicious. He looked...
proud.
Yeah. He looked happy about that, but it was more of what Obi-Wan needed to hear in that moment, I think, of like, okay, like, this isn't all my fault. You at least have some responsibility here that you made these choices. Like, currently right now, you are choosing to say that, like, I did this. I am the one.
I think it's what freed Kenobi.
Yeah, is the fact that he no longer feels this guilt of creating Vader. You didn't create Vader necessarily. Like, yeah, you're a factor in it, sure, but so is fucking everybody. Like, literally everyone on the council, every Jedi is a factor of Anakin being Vader.
100%.
When Vader says, I am what you made me, it's very much a dig at Obi-Wan, but at the same time, Anakin probably has to... Anakin wouldn't acknowledge this himself, maybe, but he's definitely a product of everybody, like, in the Jedi Order, like, of all of their problems, kind of condensed into one being.
Yeah. Well, actually, you know what's funny about that is, like, me and Tessa are, like, in Clone Wars right now, we're, like, we're the Bounty Hunter episodes, like, arc, where, like, Obi-Wan's disguise as Reiko Hardeen.
Yeah.
And we're getting to... We just passed the episode where, like, Anakin found out, and it's like, whew! Like, that was a huge factor. Like, that was a huge plot point for the show, because it really shows you the dip of, like, the council not trusting Anakin.
Yeah, he's like, you guys don't trust me, and you won't tell me anything. Like, it doesn't help his insecurities with them.
Mm-hmm.
But then we pretty
his,
much...
His ability, his like, he's got to overcome his ability to, like... prove himself, right?
Yeah.
Always biggest flaw.
Then we come back after that epic battle to Reva chasing after Luke in the Jundland Wastes, and I loved it too. I gotta say, like, I love the fact that, like, she could not bring herself to be pretty much
Vader.
What Vader, yeah, pretty much what she experienced, right? Yeah. I thought that was a very, like, I thought Reva's ending in the show was good. Like, I do like the idea that she's out there doing stuff.
I was surprised, actually. I thought for sure she was going to die.
Yeah, I thought she was going to die, too. But, like, this is cool. It's fine that she's going to go through some sort of redemption. I actually would have been totally cool with it, seeing her with Obi-Wan at the end, sort of maybe implying that he would help her, like, and guide her into a better way. Kind of like a secondary apprentice for Obi-Wan or something, you know?
I also thought that for sure that we were going to see his hut.
Me too! Oh, I totally thought we were going to see it. He packed everything up. He's going there.
That's what I thought was happening. I was like, oh my god. I was like, because then I was thinking about it. I was like, oh yeah, he has that ship now. He can probably sell that and get a house in Tatooine.
I like how that's like the first thought that we fucking had, really. Is like that we're like, oh my god, the ship, sell, house. Like,
yeah.
Clearly that's where this is going. For sure. I agree. He totally could do it. I'm actually shocked they didn't do that.
Yeah.
Then Reva leaves her lightsaber on Tatooine because that planet is now becoming the new Ilum. Like, where, like, at one point there's literally going to be fucking kyber crystals everywhere.
Yeah, like, researchers, like, they don't dig for fossils, archaeologists, they dig for lightsabers.
Yeah, you go to Tatooine, it's a graveyard of lightsabers, apparently.
Grievous is having a nervous breakdown right now.
Yeah.
And, like we all fucking called, or I don't know if all of us called this, but, like, I really suspected it. I knew we were going to get a Palpatine moment in this show. Like, we had to.
Oh, my God, that was so cool.
That was really good.
Yeah, Vader's two PS4s. One of them's for Palpatine. There we go. That's what happens.
It's so they can land party.
Yeah. He's like, oh, good. I serve on, like, you serve me, Vader. And guess what? I'm coming over in, like, 45 minutes. You ready to play some Battlefront 2?
it's the greatest game ever. I don't care what anyone else says.
Yeah, it got way better after launch.
Also, I like how, like, they made Palpatine, like Ian McDiarmid, like, they made him, like, reminiscent of, like, old Star Wars, like, holograms. Like, they really did the makeup for him to look like the fucking 70s and 80s. It was so cool.
Yeah. Like, they went above and beyond with his look. Because, like, he's always a character that changes every fucking appearance he's on screen.
I mean, he used to be a monkey wearing a shitty mask.
Yep. Every time Palpatine's on screen, I'm like, what's different? But yeah, that's our closing out of Vader in this show. I love Vader. He was 10 out of 10. I would like to see Vader show, if I'm being honest.
That's the thing. So that's my counterpoint to the Reva show. I would much rather like to see Vader hunting down Jedi.
Yeah, I want to see Hayden Christensen.
And you put Vader Reva in it. There you go.
Yeah.
Yeah, go down.
I was literally just about to say, and then obviously we move on to, but you know, you're the narrator. I don't want to take your spotlight, bro.
No. Pretty much sure. We move on to Obi-Wan on Alderaan, as we predicted earlier, yeah, with the giving Lola back to Leia. I love that she thought this was going to be, like, another, like, cousin meeting. She's like, oh, is this, like, another bullshit thing that we have to do? But it's, like, her friend, so she's all happy about it. And Obi-Wan's, like, words of, like, talking about Padme and Anakin in vague terms, which is telling her, like, what traits she has from these people, was
fucking heartbreaking.
It was beautiful, yeah. And that alongside with Leia saying, like, it's okay, like, I have two parents, like, I'm fine. I thought that was beautiful. And yeah, like, it really adds to, like, later on in the show or in the movies when, like, she's, like, with Leia being happy and excited about Obi-Wan coming to save her and shit like that. Like, that elates me. As well as later on naming her child Ben.
Ben makes so much more sense now.
It makes way more sense now. Like, beforehand, it was like, why'd you name him Ben?
But do you want to know the saddest bit?
What?
This is the only memory of Kenobi that Leia will have. Because that's the last time she sees him.
I mean, she kind of sees him on the Death Star for a second, but yeah.
For 1 second, and then he gets slaughtered.
Imagine that, right? You're like, oh my god, Ben! Fucking... oh, shit!
I love what it's like. Like, I do like that the last thing that Obi-Wan saw was them reunited.
Yeah, like, he gives the smile, too. I've seen that thing, too, where it's like, yeah, he turns, sees them, smiles, and he's like, alright, my job is done. I've put these people together. But then we got Obi-Wan kind of like, yeah, like packing up all of his shit in his place, taking his EOP to go see Owen and be like, yo, can you give him this little gift, please, for me? Like, what you doing? But yeah, he learns that instead of just watching him the whole time and insisting on this training thing, that Luke just needs to be a kid. Like, he needs to just be a person rather than be like this. Be this thing that Anakin kind of was, right? Where Anakin was taken as a child and is like, you have to, like, learn the ways of the Force and da-da-da-da-da. He sees that and maybe is like, maybe we'll just let this one play out and see how it goes.
Yeah. I think that, like, definitely...
He finally also does his hello there.
Yeah, we got the fucking moment. Like, when he was walking up, I sensed it coming, dude. When he was like...
He sounded so much more like Alec Guinness, and I love it. I really do.
I wonder if this is coming through. Listen to the audio here, folks. Ready?
Hello there.
There you go.
Hear nothing, but okay.
Nothing.
No, you guys couldn't hear it, but in the stream, they probably could hear it.
Oh.
And then closing out the show, the only way they really could have, Qui-Gon Jinn shows up. Ooh, finally.
My
two favorite... Some of my favorite characters... Both appeared in the final episode of the shows that we've watched recently.
And in one fucking scene, they, like, explain Force Ghost better than ever before.
Yeah.
Like, with him saying to Obi-Wan that, like, I was always here, you just weren't ready. Like, that to me answers so many fucking questions about Force Ghost later on, too. Where, like, I've always been like, why doesn't Anakin Skywalker show up to goddamn Ben Solo and tell him shit? It's because he's not ready. Because he doesn't accept it. I think, honestly, a big thing with dark side users is that they can't even see Force Ghosts because they don't even like the idea of being able to see that kind of thing. You know what I mean? Like, they don't...
Because they see it as more powerful.
Yeah, like, they wouldn't like to know that kind of thing, even.
I thought it was something to do with immortality. But that could be just me just, like, having assumed.
Well, because the idea of being a Force Ghost is not so much that you will be powerful forever. It's more so that you can... help people forever, right? And that you could give your wisdom to others forever rather than hoarding it for yourself. You can now, like, help the future generations forever rather than, like, in your lifetime. At least that's how I've always kind of taken it, but yeah, like, that fucking episode was a banger. It did a lot for me in general. It did a lot for the show. I would honestly give this episode like a 9.
10 for me.
It was just amazing.
The show, I would give like a solid 8. Like, because, like I said, I probably wouldn't go back and rewatch the whole show. I would probably just rewatch the last 3 episodes.
One thing I want to mention, and I absolutely love this shift, and you see it more and more as the show goes on with costume changes. And
yes.
I love so much that when you first get out, Obi-Wan is like this very panicked, very scared person. He's like, oh my god, I gotta do this. oh my god, we're gonna be hunted. Oh my god, like, I'm so fucked. Everything's right on me. And then he gets calmer and calmer and becomes definitely more of himself to the point that when you find, like, episode 4, like, he doesn't give a shit because he's like, oh, whatever, I just, everything will work out. Like, and it's so cool to, like, watch him, like, grow from this character. Also, I love him in the gray robes. He looks so good.
Actually, in the last outfit that he was wearing, like, this is what makes me wonder how much they're fucking paying attention. Like,
It's the comic
it's
one, isn't it?
It's the comic fucking thing! So I'm like, god damn, y'all clearly know what you're talking about sometimes.
Yeah. Isn't it the one where he goes and slaughters the Tuskens?
I don't... it might be the one... It might just be the diary issues that they did where it was, like, his journal. But yeah, any other closing thoughts that you guys have on the show? What do you want to say for our final Obi-Wan Kenobi thoughts?
I want more Star Wars.
I want more Star Wars like this.
Yeah.
The way it was done. Because it was beautiful. You know, seeing that story be told, like, not correctly, because that's the wrong way to put it, but, like, in such a way that it was just enjoyable from start to finish.
Yes.
And,
like, even, like, it was just good. Yeah, like we made complaint, like, some of us made complaints here and there, but, like, that didn't, like that didn't mean, like it wasn't completely, like, non-enjoyable. Like, there was always moments to, like from beginning. Like, even, like, when, like, you, there was things that we thought were silly, there was still, like, it was still overall pretty good.
Yeah.
And, like, there was still things to just enjoy.
Yeah,
I like the
chases.
Yeah, parkour.
I don't want to wrap us up pretty quick here, but I do actually have to do something. So, anyone else have any closing thoughts, or are we good to wrap up?
I'm good.
Uh-huh.
All good, baby.
All right, thank you guys so much for watching our Obi-Wan Kenobi episode 6 discussions. We'll be back next Saturday with Miss Marvel. We're going to be moving that to Saturdays now. The next Star Wars show will be Andor, so hell yeah, hopefully we'll see you for that one.
In August. Let's go.
It'll be a good fucking time.
Goodbye there, should be, I guess, what we say.
Goodbye.
Bye there.
May the Force be with you all.
May the Force be with you. Maclunkey.
Maclunkey.